us now, the voice of the Cougars, Greg Wrubell, fresh off a fantastic episode of BYU Football with head coach Kalani Sitake. Greg, nice to have you back in Studio B.
Good to be back. A great show last night. A lot of energy in the crowd. Good vibe. Kalani's great as always. Matt Hadley was a tremendous guest. And it's reinvigorating to come back in after a rough weekend, right? But yet the energy is there. The fans are there. Everyone's fired up, ready to go for Utah week. So it was a fun night last night. Kudos again to our show producer, Jerem Jordan, for putting together a great look and a great feel for the show. And we're off and running here. Three shows in and rolling.
Fantastic. It almost feels advantageous that Utah is on the schedule after what happened to BYU against LSU.
Yeah, what a great chance to show your bounce-back ability, right? You're facing early adversity. We really find out a lot about this team right away in week three. And what a great springboard it could be. We'll talk about it in a bit as to what the biggest benefit might be of a win this Saturday. But it really does, again, give you that early chance to kind of assess the resolve and character of this group.
Playing off that then, what is the identity of this team after two games?
TBD, to be determined. Kalani told us postgame he wished he really knew, particularly offensively, what our identity is. He said, we don't have one yet. And that's really the question that needs answering is this week and in weeks beyond, what becomes the identity, particularly on offense of this team? We think we have a good sense for what BYU is defensively. Offensively, we just haven't seen it yet. And so it is definitely a TBD right now.
Well, in that TBD frame of mind, what's the most perplexing aspect of this team that you've noticed statistically through the first two games of the season?
A couple of things, but one of them that really jumps out is the inability to get things going on the ground. And it relates directly to down and distance. BYU has had one third and two and zero third and ones in the first two games. Okay, so let's think about this. They've had really one kind of gimme third down where you think you can run it and get it. And by the way, they ran it and didn't get it. They had a third and two, ran for 1 yard. Okay, so this BYU team has not converted a third down via the rush yet this year.
Wow.
Last year, BYU converted more rushing third downs than passing third downs. This year, they only have six third down conversions. They're all through the air. Last year, about 20% of BYU's third down attempts were third and one or third and two. Okay, this year that number is 4%, just the one in 23 opportunities. So they're not getting to third and short. So the most perplexing thing is that they're not giving themselves chances to run the ball for third downs and haven't really run it very well. Now, this is all kind of skewed by the fact that the second team you played was what I hope is going to be and I think will be an excellent defense in LSU. They were tremendous last year, had the looks of being tremendous this year. So again, you played only two games and one is against a dominant SEC defense. So that really does kind of alter your perception a little bit. But the point is BYU's third down average distance to gain in the first two games has been over 8 yards both times. So if your average third down is 8+, that means you're averaging only a couple of yards on first and second, and that has to change for BYU.
Was LSU better than we thought they were going to be?
Well, they certainly proved that inexperience can be mitigated by tremendous speed, size, and talent. Okay, there were a lot of new guys seeing spots on that LSU defense this past week. They were playing without Arden Key and playing without suspended dudes, and they were playing with a lot of novelty. That novelty was really good novelty. and Dave Aranda, there's a reason he's a really highly paid defensive coordinator. And BYU knew all about him. I mean, he's got a resume and got a record that speaks for itself. They were among the best defenses in the country last year. And he's showing that if you keep restocking with four- and five-star talent up and down your roster, you can work with those guys.
Yeah.
And again, they show just how good they can and I think will be this year.
Where do you expect this offense to make its biggest leap this week?
I hope it's at quarterback. And Danny Etling outplayed Tanner Mangum last week. I thought BYU had the edge at QB, and Etling was the better quarterback last week. And Tanner's been okay, but I haven't really seen him settle into a rhythm of comfort yet. I want to see Tanner get on a roll where it looks like he's into that groove, and I haven't seen that yet. And that's what I expect and hope to see happens this week and in weeks beyond is Tanner really getting going to where this thing, BYU didn't have any drives, and again, it's LSU, but BYU had no drives with multiple first downs last week. Zero. So they moved the chains once, if that, and that was it. Okay, and so a lot of Tanner getting into a groove is BYU moving the sticks on consecutive series here down the field. And that really hasn't happened yet to a great degree. I thought the first week was a little hit and miss against Portland State. Again, penalties were as responsible as anything. Consider the fact, guys, that of BYU's 12 penalties, almost half have been 15-yarders.
Oh.
So this is when the penalties get really punitive. All right, you're really taking yourself off schedule with
drive killers.
So 5 of the 12 have been the major infractions. You got to reduce that. And that kind of contributed, too, to Tanner maybe not finding rhythm in week one. In week two, it was just the fact that LSU was just jamming things up. So I hope and expect that we see Tanner Mangum get more comfortable.
The running back situation is one of the more intriguing storylines with this BYU football team right now because of injuries and replacing Jamal Williams and now Riley Burt being switched to the defensive side of the ball. What do you expect from the BYU running backs moving forward?
Find a guy. Kalani speculated post-LSU that the committee approach may or may not be what BYU needs to stick with very much longer. Let's find some playmakers and give them the rock. And so whoever it is, let's find who it is rather quickly and start to lean on that guy and get him into a bit of a rhythm too.
We've been talking about the fact that this game is so much bigger than just it being the rivalry game and beating Utah. How does the outcome of this game, in your opinion, set the tone for this team as it moves forward?
There are two components to this. One is psychological, the other is practical. On the psychological standpoint, you've got to prove that you can still beat Utah. It's been six straight games. And that's a thing. Kalani says, you know, they won't talk about it, think about it, but the streak is a real thing. It's been a long time, and you want to reassert yourself in the rivalry. You need to have that as a confidence booster, showing that you are still with. And to that point, BYU's not getting blown out every year. Okay, we all know that most of these games go down to the wire. They're all touchdowns or less. 16 of the last 19 games decided by 7 points or fewer. That's a meaningful number. No one really runs away from the other team, except on rare occasions. 3 in the last 19 times, you get your 54-10, what have you. But for the most part, you still have to prove that you can finish this kind of game. So it's psychological. As it relates to LSU, too, Kalani says, we know that we're better than we showed last weekend. So it's these guys have to show to themselves that, yeah, we're much better than LSU showed us to be. So there's that psychological component. We're not as bad as 27-0, and we can still hang and beat our rivals. That's an important psychological element. The other is practical. You win the Utah game, and now you have a good shot to get out of September above 500, and then hopefully get on a bit of a roll as you get, again, comfortable with the season progressing. So there's that practical standpoint to get yourself above water and kind of stay there for a while. So I think there are really two sides of it, but they're both equally important, and Utah gives you a tremendous opportunity to show that here on Saturday.
I know it's only one game, but my goodness, 1-2 and 2-1 sound worlds different from each other going into the Wisconsin.
Yeah, we're in the middle of this, back-to-back-to-back P5 swing here, and these are home games. You expect to win your home games and play well at home. And again, should you get to 2-1, Wisconsin gives you a great opportunity then to beat a ranked team, do it at home, and that really establish some momentum. But we're talking baby steps here. You're coming off of what happened last Saturday. You've got to reassert yourself. But Kalani's really confident that there is more to this BYU team than they showed last Saturday. He knows it. He believes it. He hopes to see it this Saturday.
How has the atmosphere of the rivalry changed, in your opinion, since Coach Satake took over as head coach?
Well, we have only really 1 year to go off of, right? And I think most of it is kind of the subtext as it relates to the two head coaches, their relationship, and maybe how that might kind of trickle down to the fan bases. The two coaches like and respect each other, are fond of each other. There's connections between the two schools. And I think that, might have a chilling effect in a positive way relative to the two fan bases. Maybe dial back the animosity a little bit, because the connection that exists here with these two guys didn't exist in the previous scenario. And so, again, it's a subtextual thing, only 1 year to go off of. But I think it's an important component. Kalani and Kyle, their relationship, I think may have a trickle-down effect with everything else surrounding it. But you still want to beat your rival, and that's never going to change. Kalani's going to coach his guts out. So, too, will Kyle. And, this is the one day where, friendship is set aside. You just want to send the other guy home a loser.
Yeah. To sum up what Kalani said last night, I love him, but I want to beat him. Mm-hmm. And it's as simple as that. Okay, it's a rivalry week. across the board. BYU women's soccer taking on Utah on Friday night. BYU football taking on Utah on Saturday. Needless to say, both teams need a win against
both
their
teams
rival.
Coming off of shutout losses. So there's a lot of similarities here this weekend.
It's time. Okay. Ready the Canadian national anthem, because it's time for Greg to dig a little bit deeper into his bag of tricks for a cool thing about Canada.
Well, we all know that BYU has 8 players currently on 53-man rosters in the NFL. And by the way, that's a great thing. 8 guys on the main roster in the NFL, a few more practice squad guys like Kainaku and Michael Davis. But that's a lot of players. That's good. Let's not forget about the CFL, where at least 2 former Cougars are playing, Cody Hoffman in Ottawa, and more recently, Riker Matthews.
Yeah, Riker.
Riker Matthews with the Hamilton Tiger Cats made his first Tiger Cats start on Labor Day night. Tiger Cats got a win. And Hamilton has a connection to the BYU program that goes back a few years and even further than that. So Riker Matthews there now. KJ Hall, current BYU running back, is the son of Kalen Hall, who when he left BYU was drafted by the Hamilton Tiger Cats and got to play up in Canada. And Austin Colley, his dad played for the Hamilton Tiger Cats, and that's why Austin Colley was born in Hamilton, Ontario.
Is a tiger cat, like, is that a different animal than just a tiger? Have they just added cat to tiger?
It's better than a tiger. And better than a cat.
It's a tiger cat.
That's exactly right. It's tiger-cat. And, it's a striped animal. But, again, Canadian, in fact, it's native to Canada, actually. very, very few felines of the fierce variety are native to the northern lands, but the tiger cat is one.
Tiger cat.
Yeah.
Thank you, Greg Rivalry.
We're a funny league up there. You know, for a long time, we had the Rough Riders one word and the Rough Riders two words, two of the teams with the same names in a 9-team league. And then we have Tiger-Cats, which are, again, more than Tigers and more than Cats. So there you go.
Which Rough Riders did Steve Sarkisian play for?
Rough Riders one word.
Oh, one word.
Right. But then the Rough Riders two words figured, since there are only 9 teams and 2 of us the same name, let's change our name. So they went from the Rough Riders two words to the Red Blacks. Again, also weird. So we just can't get around it. We're a funny country that way.
Hey,
they are the Ottawa Red Blacks.
Not the Reds, nor the Blacks,
but the Red Blacks.
Red Blacks.
That's right.
Greg, it's always a pleasure, my friend. Thanks for coming in.
Okay, we'll see you next Wednesday.